Lieutenant Ringwald.
Now what?
They've got a hostage.
The district attorney's here.
Sorry about what happened, Mr. Muldaur. We'll get him back.
You think he was kidnapped?
Don't you?
Never can tell what that boy's gonna do. You see this girl on TV?
Yeah, me and half the country.
This doesn't look like a kidnapping. It looks like a party.
I think it was. I think this is a bunch of kids having a fine old time.
Well, these kids are smart. Got the wire services interested, they got the networks interested. Gotta give them a lot of credit.
Prosecutor Tom Sneddon. Yesterday, a day his office suffered a crushing defeat at the hands of Michael Jackson's jury. Well, tonight, he's talking about what happened to MSNBC's own Rita Cosby. Rita joins us now in Scarborough Country. Rita.
Joe, Tom Sneddon was quite fiery during this interview, and for the first time, we hear how the boy who accused Michael Jackson of molestation reacted to the verdict. We at MSNBC, in order to protect the boy's privacy, have chosen to remove his name, so you may at times not hear the audio for a brief second during the interview. But what you will hear is a boisterous prosecutor who defends his case through and through. First, I asked the district attorney if he was personally devastated by the jury's decision.
We felt that we did the best job that we could, and that's it. I mean, That's our philosophy, you know. You do the best you can, and we're not the judge, we're not the jury. We're the people who put on the case, and we feel that we did a very good job.
So you believe that Michael Jackson molested this boy, even to this day?
Rita, it's this simple. Not only do I believe that, but all the people associated with this case who's had an opportunity to be with, to hear, we interacted. This is not Tom Sneddon. This decision to go forward with this case was a decision that was made by a team of people, a number of lawyers beyond myself, and there isn't a person involved in that decision that in any way, shape, or form has ever wavered in their belief that was telling the truth.
And you believe that to this day?
Of course.
The jury, though, another team, you know, 8 women, 4 men, said no way. They said the evidence wasn't there.
That's what they said, and I don't quarrel with juries. But you're asking me what my belief is, and my belief has not wavered, and it will not waver ever in that regard. And that's why we have juries, instead of having prosecutors make those decisions.
Is it possible, though, sir, that this boy and this mother, who have lied before in other cases like the JCPenney case, totally fooled you guys and they were lying again? Totally fooled you guys and they were lying again?
No, and then that's a misrepresentation of what happened in JCPenney's.
How so? Because even it sounds like she had exaggerated some things before.
Well, all right, exaggerating is not the same thing as being a liar. And what a mother does and says is different from what a child says or does. And you were asking me specifically about, and I don't think that if the mother had even done something wrong, that you visit the sins of the mother on the son. If you have real belief in the integrity of what the young child was telling you. So I think that, you know, this tendency to kind of mesh these things together as if one's dependent on the other, I think is probably a fallacy which a lot of people have bought into, perhaps even the jury. But like I said, I'm not quibbling with the jury's verdict. I'm just, you're asking me my personal opinion, and I'm telling you that there isn't a person associated with the prosecution of this case that has ever wavered in their belief in.
you personally had a personal vendetta against Michael Jackson. You were driven by it, that you spent all this taxpayer money, hundreds, you know, of search warrants, tons of time, and it was a waste of taxpayers' money because the jury sort of laughed it off.
Rita, first of all, there weren't 100 search warrants in this case. Second of all, we didn't spend a ton of money. And third of all, that whole idea of a revenge is such nonsense. I say to you folks in the media that really believe that garbage, come down here and check my life. See what I've been doing the last 10 years. You know, I have a family. I have a large family. I have grandkids. I play sports. I work in the community. I volunteer my time. If you think I have given this one passing thought once that case ended in 1993 and 94, you're not in touch with reality. You're not in touch with reality. I mean, I had a chance to make a cost probably $1 million writing a book on that case and turned it down.
Will you ever write a book?
To go on.
Will you ever write a book on this?
I had chances. Probably not. I don't. But I mean, I had a chance back then to do that. I had a chance to go on TV. I had a chance to be interviewed. I never said one word after that press conference, ever in 10 years.
Now,
so I mean,
go ahead.
It's the truth. I mean, just look at it. It's the truth. Every time he would do something, they would call me from a comment everywhere, Japan, France, England, New York, everywhere. The media would go crazy. And I didn't take any of those calls. I never made a comment about anything. I really, really, really was not involved in following Michael Jackson's life when said he was not going to cooperate with our investigation. That was over with, and I moved on. And that's the truth. I know that doesn't make it nice for you folks because it doesn't sell. But that's the truth.
There is word tonight that Jackson and his team, I guess, have indicated that they want you to immediately surrender these photos that were taken, that you have access to, of Michael Jackson's private parts, that they are fearful that they're going to be leaked out in the press somehow. Will you surrender those photos?
Arita, that's just another instance where the defense team doesn't know what they're talking about. I don't have those photos. The sheriff's department doesn't have those photos. Nobody can get those photos without a court order. There are only three names on the signature to get in there, and you need signatures from two of them and a judge's approval. So this is just typical of what's been going on in this case ever since it's happened. The people don't know what they're talking about, and it's not true.
So what do you say to Michael Jackson's team who are saying, we're worried that Tom Sneddon's going to leak this out?
It's the same old nonsense. I can't leak out what I can't get to, can I?
So you can guarantee that they won't
be leaked out? I don't have the negatives. What did I just tell you? Nobody can get access to them without a judge's approval.
So they're not going anywhere, is what you're saying.
That's what I said, and that's what I've been saying, and that's the truth.
Now, if you saw Michael Jackson...
These things were...
If you saw Michael Jackson on the street, you ran into him, or run into him again, what would you say to him?
That's a highly unlikely scenario.
But if it were to happen,
I run into each...
what would you say to him if you could see him? If you happen to run into him?
I wouldn't say him. I'd probably nod and keep walking.
Would you walk away?
I said I'd probably nod and keep walking. I wouldn't go out of my way to avoid him. I don't feel any vindictiveness towards this man. In a lot of respects, he's a fairly pathetic person in the sense of what he's gone through. And I don't have any vendetta against him. It's just that simple.
Are you sad, sir, as your term is ending, that this is this may be the last, you know, huge case? You're certainly never going to have a case like this with a year and a half left in your term. Are you sad this is the way you're going out?
No, I just don't think you people understand who I am. And who I am is that I tell the kids that I've coached, and I tell my kids that I've raised, that if you do the best job that you can possibly do, and you do it for the right reasons, whether you win or whether you lose is unimportant. The question is, can you walk off the field at the end of the game with your chin up and say, I gave it my all, and I played fair and square, and I did the right thing? If you've done that, you've got nothing to apologize for, nothing to put your head down about. And I'm proud of my office. I'm proud of the people who participated. I'm proud of the sheriff's department. And if anybody thinks that because we lost this case that I'm going to walk around in a sackcloth with my chin down around my knees, is crazy, because I'm not.
Our thanks to the district attorney. And by the way, Sneddon is a well-known figure in Santa Barbara. He's a father of nine kids. He became the district attorney for the county in which Neverland resides in 1983, when Michael Jackson was already a household name and a megastar. And Joe, as you can tell, he does not shy away from some pretty tough questions.
Man, Rita, that was an explosive interview. Now, you talked to the other side today also. What is the Jackson family going through today?
And you know what? Just sheer relief, Joe. They just seem to be so joyed and so happy over the decision yesterday. I don't think anybody knows, you know, how the decision was going to go yesterday when the jury verdict came down. Both sides had no idea what the outcome was going to be. So I think incredible relief. The other thing I'm also gathering is that Michael Jackson, a very close person to Michael Jackson, said to me, today he is mentally and physically exhausted. He's sleeping, but they also say he's planning the next step in his career, always looking ahead, planning the next step in his career, always looking ahead. And my understanding is that they had a big event most of the time yesterday in Neverland for the several hours after the verdict came down. And now most of them are going back to their homes, trying to go on with their lives. Joe?
Rita Cosby, thanks again. I'll tell you what, that was a heck of an interview. Heck of an interview. Thank you. We appreciate it.
Wait. You know how these Bashir... Hey, you know how Bashir zoomed in on him holding hands? Do that the same thing.
It's because you know...
Because that's what a mother does with a son, or a father does with a son, you know?
Yeah.
And they try to make it out to be something wrong and dirty.
Put your back straight.
The hand holding thing.
Okay.
How did that make you feel?
Oh, we're on camera?
Yeah.
Oh.
We are?
Yeah, is it rolling?
Oh, God! This is the outtakes of the out.
Please, Dad, do whatever they say. These are heavy-duty criminals. Oh, God.
Are we gonna do this thing or what?
Listen, this was your idea. Be serious.
Yeah. Daddy? Just remember, you get somebody's ear in the mail, it's mine.
You guys are really boring.
Hey, listen to this.
Listen, Billie Jean. Come on down to C101 in beautiful Corpus Christi and collect yourself a brand new Yamaha, courtesy of Douglas Motorcycle on North Avenue. And from all us jocks, you're at C101, where fair is fair.
Did you hear that?
A Yamaha? Are you serious?
He had growth spurts during chemotherapy.
I went from 4'10" to 5'4".
See? Medicine don't know it all, do they?
According to Gavin, it was Michael's friendship and support that helped him beat the cancer. They've remained close friends ever since.